are CKCO-TV.
The CTV News, special edition, with Lloyd Robertson in Ottawa.
Good evening from Parliament Hill and the lobby of the House of Commons on this federal budget night. Well, this was the day we'd been waiting for, of course, holding our breath, wondering how bad it would be. As it turned out, the government gave middle-class Canadians a break with no new income tax hikes and leveled its guns at the wealthy, the civil servants, and its own departments. When Finance Minister Paul Martin finally had his say with his budget, the news for most people wasn't all that bad. But beware, there will be a price to pay in the near future as the provinces are forced to make do with less and less money from Ottawa. Here are some of the highlights of the government's new spending plan. No increases in personal income tax. Federal gas tax up 1.5 cents a liter, effective midnight tonight. RRSP contribution limits frozen at this year's level for 2 years. 45,000 public service jobs will be eliminated. Corporations and banks will pay more tax. Business subsidies to be cut by 60%. Block transfer payments to the provinces slashed by $4.5 billion beginning in 1997-98. As for the deficit, the government is on target for 95-96 at $32.7 billion and will reduce it to $25 billion in 1996-97. And one more footnote, say goodbye to the $2 bill. It will be replaced next year by a $2 coin, already dubbed the doubloon by some people. Praise for this new budget is not unanimous, of course. The opposition in Ottawa is furious, but clearly this is one budget designed to be voter-friendly. Our Ottawa Bureau Chief Craig Oliver has more on Paul Martin's way of doing things.
The cuts start here. To reduce costs, for the first time ever, the finance department is charging for the budget documents.
I have to pay for the pain.
Yes, sorry.
They are buying Paul Martin's vision of the future, one of a smaller, cheaper, decentralized national government.
Our view is straightforward. If government doesn't need to run something, it shouldn't. And in the future, Mr. Speaker, it won't.
House of Commons colleagues gave Martin a standing ovation, out of relief, no doubt, that he's made a start at reducing the deficit without awakening the dormant dragon of voter revolt.
In this budget, like last year's, we are not increasing personal income tax rates one iota.
Martin is the first finance minister since the Second World War to launch a frontal attack on government spending and debt, and he promises he won't let up.
We will hit our deficit target for 95-96. We will hit our target for 96-97. And of equal importance, the downward track established by the actions taken in this budget will continue in the years thereafter.
Although Martin failed to pinpoint a date when Canada will have a balanced budget, which would have appeased the markets, he insists they should be satisfied that he's met his deficit target.
It doesn't take a stroke of genius to understand that we have broken the back of the deficit and that, in fact, that the rating agencies should have no concern.
Is dishonest, it is cowardly, and it is hypocritical.
Reform Party leader Preston Manning condemns a budget that still allows government debt to pile up uncontrollably.
That budget does not fix the debt problem, and all those chickens will come home to roost by 1997.
Bloc Québécois leader Lucien Bouchard is troubled over cuts in the social safety net transfers to provinces.
We can say that it's a tough budget, but tough on the wrong people, tough on poor people.
Oh, what I can do is I send you,
Do you have another question?
A finance department hotline was flooded with queries from across the country. Martin wasted not a moment in hitting the television interviews, selling his version of events. But he still has a selling job to do with some of his colleagues in the Liberal caucus, who are breaking with the traditional solid support.
The cuts to government programs were actually amputations. The public service weren't axed, they were dynamited.
In managing a credible shot at the deficit while still leaving the large middle class of the country relatively unscathed, Martin has produced a politically well-crafted document. The people and the regions he's targeted for pain will have a hard time finding sponsors. The Reform Party, after all, is only asking for more. So it's possible that the real opposition to Martin's budget may come from within the Liberal Party. Craig Oliver, CTV News, Ottawa.
There is one basic formula this budget is based on, and no one needs a degree in economics to understand it. A loonie saved is a loonie earned. Cost-cutting is the order of the day. Peter Murphy reports on some of the deepest cuts and how certain people will be affected.
I'm not very happy with this budget.
Vera Belopolsky is an environmental engineer who's been unemployed for the past 3 months. She's pleased the government is trying to cut its deficit, but she worries that its deficit-fighting measures may make it harder for her to find work.
For me, as an unemployed person, there's nothing in this budget that I can rely on. The increasing number of unemployed on the market. So I have more competition, I have to fight harder.
We laid out a firm course of action.
In Vancouver, more than 30 civil servants on a training course jeered Finance Minister Martin and his budget. Many worried about their future and whether the deficit acts would chop them off the government payroll.
You know, we're an easy target because, we're the employees of the government.
I think it was evident and clear today that the Canadians who can afford it the least are the ones who will pay for the deficit.
It's changed Canada to a leaner, meaner society.
Across the country, at the annual meeting of the Canadian Federation of Agriculture, the talk was of pain. Pain farmers would now endure as farm subsidies get slashed.
There'll be suffering for everybody. Anytime you take the amount of money that has been coming into the industry in the way of transportation subsidies in particular away, there's going to be suffering.
For these women, members of the National Action Committee on the Status of Women, the budget was a betrayal.
On behalf of many women, I feel angry, I feel betrayed, I feel that it's basically a lie. I feel that the Liberal government has lied to us.
This is a fight for our lives. We're talking about services for battered women. We're talking about services to children.
The military cutbacks and the closing of bases has local residents worried.
Without question, we're very concerned about CFB Calgary closing. In the past, it has meant $140 million in the community, roughly 4,100 personnel in total.
Martin's budget has sharpened the debate between left and right in Canada, between the old and the new conscience.
It's not a good budget. It's a dreadful budget. It redefines the federal government as a business. It no longer looks at the consequences for people. It looks at balance sheets, and balance sheets almost exclusively.
I think that spending cuts of this magnitude are a start, but the cuts have to be made much deeper and right across the board.
Vera Belopolsky says while the government battles its deficit, she's fighting to find work, and she doesn't think the government's actions will help her.
Tomorrow, it won't be any much different than yesterday or today. But I'm not giving up.
Peter Murphy, CTV News, Toronto.
The budget will have a profound and far-reaching impact on the provinces and the way they do business with Ottawa. The new block funding arrangements will give the provinces more freedom to spend federal transfer payments as they see fit. But with Ottawa sending them less cash, the provinces will also be responsible for the inevitable cuts to come that will affect every single taxpayer. CTV's Alan Fryer reports.
Transfer payments. Think of them as a kind of national squeeze play. Ottawa squeezes the provinces squeeze their cities, universities, and hospitals, which in turn put the squeeze on the people they serve.
Can you sit down, Mr. Bender?
If she had contracted her viral infection last year, young Shauna Tobin would still be in hospital. Instead, as part of a hospital plan to save money, she's at home, and it's her mom, not a nurse or a doctor, who's looking after her, and the device that's pumping the medicine into her veins. The result? Shauna's stay here was reduced from 5 weeks to 9 days. Big savings for the hospital, and for Patricia Tobin, a good experience. But
I hope that it doesn't get to the point where it's forced on everybody, because I do know for some people it wouldn't work out.
Paul Martin says that starting next year, in other words, starting after the Quebec referendum, the provinces are going to get squeezed even more. He's cutting back on the amount and changing the way Ottawa hands over the money. But, and this but is aimed squarely at Quebec, he's also giving the provinces a lot more say over how the money's spent.
These measures will have a...
In effect, says the finance minister, giving Quebec what it's always wanted by changing the way Canada works.
dans son renouvellement perpétuel.
But Quebec sovereignists were insisting the only thing really being transferred to the provinces is more of the federal deficit, and even that's been timed for after the vote on sovereignty.
To hide the blow that he will give to Quebecers after the referendum, I think that we should fight that. We sovereignists and Quebecers in general should fight that.
After years and years of negligence, the federal government is shoveling the overflow of snow in our own backyard, which is absolutely unacceptable.
Other premiers were furious, but for very different reasons.
It is nothing less than the fracture of the partnership that has built caring and compassion in the province of Ontario.
This is one which is a direct attack to our social safety net.
In pre-referendum Quebec anyway, this budget will be played by both sides as much for its politics as its economics. The continuing national squeeze play that most can only watch from the sidelines. Alan Fryer, CTV News, Montreal.
The hike in the gasoline tax will be one of the more visible aspects of this new budget, but for some people, running the family car isn't the only thing that just got more expensive. Roger Smith has more on what the budget could mean to your pocketbook and your taxes.
Jim and Laura Scott consider themselves average Canadians. Two kids, family income of about $60,000, and no desire to pay an extra penny to government. So the budget brought a pleasant surprise.
We are not increasing personal income tax rates one iota.
Finally, the idea that Canadians are just taxed to death and they're not going to take any more. So at least they listened to that and said, all right, we can't touch that particular area. No more
taxes! Amid rumors of more taxes on everything from lottery winnings to dental plans, anti-tax rallies sent a message loud and clear. And organizers say Martin heard.
So we were expecting a much larger tax grab than what we've actually seen in this budget. So I think that taxpayers have scored at least a partial victory.
But they will pay at the pumps, an extra $500 million a year, the biggest tax grab of all. In lineups for a last cheap fill-up, resignation and anger.
About paying more for gas at the midnight? I think it sucks.
How do you feel about having to pay more for gas?
Not too good.
No.
But the hell can you do?
But the Liberals aimed mainly at easy targets, slapping tax hikes on big corporations and banks.
I'm not going to say we're pleased that that taxes are going up, or that we're surprised. But you know, at the same time, I guess you pay a share of it, whether you like it or not.
Among loopholes to be closed, dentists, lawyers, and accountants will lose a money-saving tax deferral.
We're wondering why we had to stand first in line in terms of Mr. Martin's deficit reduction target.
All in an effort, said Martin, to make the tax system more fair. But some critics say the wealthy still get off too light.
I think the champagne corks will be popping on Wall Street, and a lot of Canadians are really losing out here.
As Martin said, no one likes to pay tax. So the grumbling is not so surprising as the fact there's so little of it. That's mainly because taxpayers expected a mugging and their pockets were barely picked. Roger Smith, CTV News, Ottawa.
We'll be back here on Parliament Hill with the all-important reaction to the budget from the business community right after this.
It seems when buying a car these days, you need algebra to figure out the cost. At GM, there's no advanced math needed because we only offer everyday upfront prices. It's called GM value pricing, the sensible way to buy a car or truck.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away. Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day.
Watch for falling prices at Walmart, all over the store. Always low prices, always Walmart. Always.
Buying a car doesn't have to be a test of your patience. At GM, we put the fun back into it by offering no hooks and no bait. Just everyday, upfront GM value pricing. The sensible way to buy a car or truck.
Continuing from Ottawa, Paul Marson must not only sell his budget proposals to Canadians, he must also satisfy jittery international money markets. Later this week, he'll visit New York to reassure investors there. But already, Ottawa's proposals to reduce the country's deficit have received a generally positive verdict. CTV's Jim O'Connell reports.
45,000 jobs cut.
Traders on Wall Street liked what they saw. A tough budget with no surprises.
If the market's happy to see that the numbers are basically what they expected, or maybe even a little bit better.
The budget also bolstered confidence in the Canadian dollar, which immediately rose on foreign exchange markets.
Oh, really?
38.80 on the dollar. They like the dollar.
Largely because of its attack on the deficit.
He has left himself a lot of room down the road to have the deficit lower.
The mood was also positive at the Canadian consulate in New York, where members of the financial community gathered to pass judgment on the budget.
This doesn't slash and burn that deficit, but it does get them on the right road to starting to stabilize it, so I think it's a very positive message.
I would think that the market would be very, very pleased with that kind of movement.
Canada's massive debt has caused a great deal of nervousness in New York. The influential Wall Street Journal recently declared Canada an honorary member of the Third World. The author of that editorial was much more optimistic after seeing the budget.
Canada is still in fiscal trouble, but it's making clear progress. And this budget is a very important down payment on reform. It'll just have to be sustained.
Transport Minister Doug Young was quick to assure investors that the fiscal cleanup will be sustained regardless of economic changes.
If there are any changes on the downside, we're going to get there anyway, come hell or high water.
Analysts are wondering what effect, if any, this budget will have on Canada's credit rating, which has been placed on probation by a New York credit agency. A final decision on that won't be made for weeks. But Finance Minister Paul Martin will be here on Friday trying to convince Wall Street that Canada's fiscal mess is at least on the road to being cleaned up. Jim O'Connell, CTV News, New York.
And joining me now to put his perspective on the budget, CTV's Ottawa Bureau Chief Craig Oliver. Craig, happy news, it would seem, from New York and the money markets. Has the finance minister in all kinds of areas today delivered what was expected of him?
He's given people what he promised, what he sort of set up public opinion for. No taxes, that was very important in terms of public support for this budget. As far as the markets were concerned, he gave them a credible crack at reducing the deficit. Most of all, he promised more to come. The problem is that we have probably tonight had a seminal evening. We are entering a new era of long-term restraint. Universality, the social contract will be stretched to the breaking point or perhaps be things of the past in a few years. If Martin is serious about continuing this kind of reduction in deficits, then those of us who didn't get hit tonight shouldn't be congratulating ourselves so early. Further tax cuts of all kinds, government spending cuts will be very necessary because he's still piling on $25 billion a year, Lloyd, in more spending than the government is bringing in. The ship of state is going on, the debt is piling up on the deck, and Martin has only said, slow down the engines. He hasn't said, make a turn, by any means.
Craig, thanks very much.
Nightly.
We'll be back from Ottawa shortly with comments from our viewers about today's budget, but first, Sandy Rinaldo has other news of this day right after this.
You're looking at one Canadian.
Maybe we should have 28-hour days. 24 doesn't seem to be enough.
Between his job, his wife's job, and raising their children, it's a busy life. So when they need a mortgage, a Royal Bank rep will come to them. It's a service designed for his family's schedule. After all, we got to be Canada's largest bank, one customer at a time.
Coming up on CKCO TV News, Ontario thaws out after a rough day on the roads. Ice storms lock down the province. Details after the CTV News.
I
I shampoo every day, but my scalp still itches.
Now there's Scalpicin for deep scalp itch that goes beyond dandruff. It's clear liquid, not shampoo. Contains medicine proven effective for deep scalp itch.
The itch is gone.
Scalpicin.
I have just the thing for that cold.
Most kids think that medicine has to taste bad. There's one cold medicine that relieves both kids and cold symptoms. Dimetapp. Grape-flavored Dimetapp Elixir. Recommended time after time by pediatricians and pharmacists. After all, a cold medicine can't work if you can't get it down.
You like Dimetapp?
Grape-flavored Dimetapp Elixir. It relieves kids, as well as cold symptoms.
Consumers today are looking for a much stronger agent. They're looking for more service. They're looking for stronger companies to represent them in negotiating their properties.
Coldwell Banker. Support you can count on.
The woman who could give O.J. Simpson his alibi took the stand today. Rosa Lopez, who once worked next door to the Simpson house, testified for the defense. She did it on videotape and without the presence of the jury. Her testimony involved Simpson's white Ford Bronco. Lopez said she saw it parked outside Simpson's house at about 8:15.
Describe for the court how the Bronco was parked.
Un poquito chueco.
A little bit crooked.
That it was crooked is crucial because Lopez said the Bronco was parked the same way when she saw it 2 hours earlier, rather 2 hours later, at the time the murders were committed. Lopez's testimony will be shown to the jury when the defense presents its case, not expected for several weeks. In other news, a powerful car bomb exploded in a crowded market in Iraq this morning. More than 50 people were killed and 80 others injured. It happened in the small city of Zako, in a region controlled by Iraq's small but militant Kurdish minority. Police around the world are looking for this man, a 28-year-old stock trader, who has ruined England's oldest investment bank. Nicholas Leeson broke the Barings Bank when he used bank money to speculate in the Japanese stock market. He ended up losing more than $1 billion. Among its patrons, Barings counts the Queen and Prince Charles. Their assets, along with all of Barings' clients, have been frozen. British scientists credit global warming with this, a massive iceberg floating northward from Antarctica into the Pacific. It is 77 kilometers long, 48 wide, and about 200 meters thick. It apparently broke off an ice shelf south of New Zealand, where temperatures over the past 50 years have risen by about 4 degrees. A dozen U.S. airlines got the green light today to fly nonstop routes into Canada. As part of the Open Skies Treaty, the airlines will begin direct service to Montreal, Toronto, and Vancouver. The idea is to expand air travel, increase competition, and reduce fares for Canadian and American consumers. Punishment today for a prominent Quebec nationalist who made intolerant comments about cultural minorities. Bloc Québécois leader Lucien Bouchard fired MP Philippe Paré from two referendum committees for saying only old-time Quebecers should decide the province's future. And in another embarrassing incident, acting Premier Bernard Landry was forced to reprimand Pierre Bourgault. The former PQ advisor had called Anglophones who vote against sovereignty racist. And more than 1,200 AMP workers in Ontario may save their jobs by agreeing to wage cuts. The company had planned to close 15 stores because they were losing money. When we return, budget talk. Paul Martin had his say, and now it's your turn.
For the most impressive things along life's highway, you need only look to nature. For the most impressive way to appreciate the view, you need only look to Acura. A sophisticated balance of performance, reliability, and quality craftsmanship. Acura. Engineered in a driving sense to bring heaven a lot closer to Earth.
Bruce and Susan just flew here free, thanks to the new Royal Trust Canadian Plus Visa card. You could fly free too. Call 1-800-434-PLUS and get the card that gives you wings.
Gillette's revolutionary clear gel antiperspirant. Not a stick, a soft gel that goes through underarm hair to the skin surface where wetness begins. For powerful protection, Gillette Clear Gel Antiperspirant.
It's happening in a major way. Canada's best-selling brand of major appliances have gone on sale. It's the Kenmore Major Appliance Sale at Sears. Now's the time to save on over 125 different Kenmore major appliances. And if you use your Sears card, don't pay till October 95, plus earn major Sears Club points. And all Kenmore appliances come with a Kenmore commitment. So come to Sears and get a major deal on a major appliance. Sale ends March 1st.
Ah, boy, it must be another Kenmore sale. Look at that.
Expect more from Sears.
Arsenic, cyanide, mercury, lead, ammonia, tar, nicotine. Cigarette smoke is a lethal brew of over 4,000 chemicals. And it kills 40,000 Canadians every year.
We close tonight with some comments and criticism about today's budget from ordinary Canadians. We asked you to phone us, fax us, or send us your views by email, and we were flooded with responses. CTV's Del Archer has this sampling of opinion from all across the country.
The information superhighway is our first stop with comments like these. Considering how deeply we are in debt and the amount of interest we pay on it, one could cry. A poor budget, weak, and nothing but grandstanding. Too little, too late for the generation following the early baby boomers. Then there were messages like these. It is probably the least rocky course we can chart in these dangerous waters. And Paul Martin seems to have stolen the clothes from the Reform Party. Rather than having a plan to restructure, he seems to have a plan to present only what he can get away with in the bond market. Then we went to the phone.
Deb Allen from Ottawa. Once again, they're going after the small people. Why don't they get rid of all these senators and their big salaries and their pension on pensions?
Bruce Johnson, Penticton, British Columbia. The major disappointment in this budget, as far as I can see, is that he didn't address anything to control the drastic and devastating underground economy.
My name is Holly Butisi, and I'm calling from Swift Current, Saskatchewan. I believe that in all fairness, this budget has done a good job. It's targeting the rich people who can afford to be taxed.
Hi, it's Terry Donovan calling from Sault Ste. Marie. I was very disappointed that they didn't raise the price of cigarettes.
Your observations kept our fax machine humming, too. A good budget, one that will be recognized by the international finance community as being on target. Paul Martin gave the people, farmers, small business, and large corporations, including banks of this country, a reality check. Other opinions weren't so glowing. I work in the petroleum industry and feel the federal government should tax something other than fuel. We thank you for your comments.
And that's the kind of day it's been on this budget day, Monday, February 27th. Tomorrow on Canada AM, from across the country and from the international financial community, more reaction to Paul Martin's budget. I'm Lloyd Robertson for Sandy Rinaldo, Craig Oliver, all of us here at CTV News. Good night. Hope it's been a reasonably good budget day for you.
CTV News, Canada's most watched newscast.